We'll skip now to Dr. Rajesh Gandhi, who's going to speak to us about the use of JESS kind of fixators for the distal radius.
Good morning, everybody. After a very heavy discussion on the pelvis fractures, let us come down to the earth. I'll be talking something about the use of external fixators and how it stands against the plating in the lower end of the radius, which is the commonest fractures all of us encounter in a day-to-day practice. Now, is the available evidence is the cause of a variation in the practice? A lot of people do different forms of treatment for the lower end of the radius. There are people who do just the close reduction with the pinning. There are people who do close reduction, pinning, and stabilize with the external fixator also. The combination of treatments, and some of them are platers, they would just do the plating, nothing else. Lower end radius, comminuted fracture, only plating. Now, why is there a lot of variation? Is it based on the evidence or is it based on me myself? I'm not too sure. Now, let's look at the treatment modalities. I'm not going to go into the details of how to apply the fixators, etc. We'll discuss about the treatment modalities and what are the pros and cons and what is the evidence, what we have right now. Now, as I was just enumerating, the treatment of the options are the reduction and pinning, close reduction and external fixator, and combination of both, open reduction and plating, and other methods. The which method to be used and how to do it. Now, intra-articular comminuted fractures of the distal end of treatment, because there are many treatments available, there are proponents for the plating and there are proponents for the external fixators. And there are people who use both as and when they feel comfortable with a particular line of treatment. Now, these are the type of fractures which we see quite commonly, wherein there is a combination, you can say the bag of bones type of picture in the lower end of the radius. Now, people who do the plating, now what are the advantages of the plating? Well, you can almost get the anatomical reduction. Mobilization is much quicker. You can start mobilization as early as the second day. The union rates are good. The posterior rehabilitation period is reduced to a great extent. And the early return of the function is achieved very quickly. Now, what are the disadvantages of the plating? It's an open operative procedure. The mentality of the Indian human being, Indian population is, when you tell them you have to do the open surgery, fair number of people chuck out. Now, the chances of infection are there because we are opening it up. And many times it is associated with a decent soft tissue trauma. Now, the anatomical reduction is always not feasible when there are dorsal fragments. Well, the proponents of the plating would always say that when there is a dorsal fragment, put in a dorsal plate. Well, it will definitely be looking like a lohar chal, what Dr. Tara Porowala used to say. And I don't think people are comfortable doing plating on both the sides. People have been doing two-pillar, three-pillar plating. Not everybody is comfortable doing that. And then the post-operative scar is there. The tendon ruptures are common when there is a dorsal plating. If the screw length, when it is put on the volar side, if it is bigger, then also it can irritate the tendons, and the ruptures are known. The very rare, you can get a vascular and a median nerve injuries. And definitely it is costly. So what do you do? Now, external fixator is one of the options. I am not telling you that it is available or it is to be applied in each and every case. It is one of the options which should be explored and which should be used as and when it is needed. Now, what are the advantages? It is a minimally invasive procedure. Anesthesia duration is very short. Chances of infection are lesser and very easy to master. Even a junior most surgeon can be reasonably good enough in a short span. And well, it is cost effective, or Prime Minister would be very happy. In Ayushman Bharat program, this can be implemented. Even in the private setup also, it can be done that way. Now, when we are applying for the external fixator in a upper extremity, particularly in the hand and the wrist, few things already has been told by Dr. Sangeet, but I would add few things. By and large, Sangeet has shown all the pins as a threaded pins. In a upper extremity, by and large, we use the non-threaded pins. Second thing is that the pre-stressing, very important. If you pre-stress, then chances of pull-out is very less. It was noticed JESS fixators, those who are using JESS fixators on a regular basis would vouch for this. That whenever pre-stressing has been done, it stands well and chances of pull-outs are lesser. Now, there are distinct disadvantages of external fixator. Anatomical reduction is not always feasible. Though the radial length is established, but the fragments, which are punched, the die punch fragments, many times cannot be reduced completely. Well, that can be done by toggling up, by closed toggling with the K-wire, blunt side of the K-wire. One can raise it up. And pin track infections are fairly common. As Sangeet pointed out, it is almost about 10 to 12%. Well, what series he had shown was about 14%. Now, most of the pin track infections occur because one has not followed the true guidelines. One of them is make a small cut in the skin. When you are going through the skin, there's a necrosis of the skin which makes it vulnerable for the infection. Also, because there are unthreaded pins, the heat generated at the point of entry of the bone is much lesser. And that's why the chances of infection reduces. And when you pre-stress, again, the pin holds well and chances of infection reduces. So that is one of the advantages. Now, what are the other disadvantages? Well, if you get a swelling on day one, remember that you have overstretched. Ligamentotexis is we have overstretched it. So that is the time. Those are the people who get a stiffness of the finger and later stiffness of the wrist. To avoid that, I think a proper radiological evaluation is a must. And rehabilitation is slightly prolonged because the wrist rehabilitation starts only after we have removed the X-fix. Now, it is cumbersome to carry around. A lot of people do not like that. Now, these are a few pictures. This is on day one. In the evening of the day, we removed the dressing to show and picturize it. So, even mobilization in the external fixator also can be started as early as day one. Of course, the wrist fix cannot be started. We have started putting in the hinge, but we wouldn't recommend that it should be started immediately for the wrist. Now, what are the criteria for choosing the outcome, and that decides and governs the line of treatment what one is going to go? Now, the functional outcome is very important, ultimate function. Now, dash score, grip strength, and finger and wrist joint movements. Now, radiological evaluation is done by the measuring of the radial length, what we have achieved, measuring of the ulnar variance and the tilt of the lower radius. And, well, arthroscopic evaluation has been started by some in Western countries. I don't think many people are doing arthroscopy over here, so they will do the evaluation. So, evaluation is mainly dependent on the functional outcome and the radiological evaluation. Now, what does the evidence say? Now, is it really necessary to restore the radial anatomical parameters after the distal radius fractures to get the maximum outcome? Now, Dario and his colleagues have published a paper where their experience was suggesting that the ulnar variance and the volar tilt were the most important radiological parameters. If they are restored well, then the final outcome is very good. And they have done the follow-up for 3 years, minimum 3 years. People who have followed up for minimum 3 years were the only people who were included in the study. And they have found this. Now, In Calcutta, there was a prospective trial conducted by Dr. Soumya Ghosh and his colleagues. What did they find? They have a limited group of 60 people only. And what did they find? The external fixator and the volar buttress produces almost equivalent functional results in a distal articular fractures, with volar buttress plate having better anatomical result and external fixation in the present study. Now, what they have detailed, that the overall functional outcome was almost the same, but immediate mobilization plus radiological evaluation was better in terms of the plating. So it is something which should be kept in mind. Now, there was a meta-analysis conducted by the Chinese group Dong Wang for the external fixator versus the plating. Now, what did they find? They found a very small difference in the two groups on imaging examination. The locking plate has the advantage of maintaining reduction. However, no significant difference was found regarding outcome. They have done a study of about 40 to 41 different studies. They have done the meta-analysis and they have found this. Now, unfortunately, not many meta-analyses are done. Not many studies are done. This was published in Journal of Hand and Traumatology. Now, another study which was done in the external fixator versus the open reduction with a plate by Esposito and all, what they found, the overall, there was a very clinical difference in ORF with the plate fixation and external fixation group. Now, ultimately, what it boils down to, that the ultimate outcome at the end of 3, 6 months and 1 year, possibly functional outcome is almost the same. Now, what the AOS recommendation is, the AOS is unable to recommend for or against the locking plates in a patient over the age of 55 who are treated operatively. Now, their state of recommendation was inconclusive. What inconclusive recommendation means, that there is a lack of a compelling evidence that resulted in an unclear balance between the benefits and the potential harm. So, what does it boil down to? The plating and the external fixator, both are a good treatment modalities. Do what one is more conversant with, and what one, the person's functional outcome and expectations have to be taken into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajesh. So, but you said AAOS recommendations.
Yeah.
So when it suits you, you bring in Modi, ki sasta hai, and then when it suits you, you say AAOS says plating is, there's no conclusion.
I know you have pathological dislike for Modi.
What does the AAOS say about, no, I'm a proponent of everything. What does the AAOS say about fixators?
See, AAOS recommendation, basically, they have found the similar outcomes, that the plating gives a better result. But they are not able to recommend fixator as a primary line of treatment because the evidence is inconclusive. That is what they have mentioned. And it is very clear that the whatever analysis they have done, they have taken multiple parameters. In fact, in one of their series, they have done the arthroscopic evaluation, but which is a very small series. Now, arthroscopic evaluation, they say that it is one of the very good way of knowing what is the articular cartilage is looking like at the end of it. So whatever we are accepting as a 2 millimeter step is acceptable. That is what everyone says. And the radial length, if it is achieved completely and the step is there, then the scaphoid unit articulation, which is taking place in the scaphoid and the lunate fossa of the lower end of the radius, it does not cause problem at all because there is no collapse of the lunate and the scaphoid. So what it recommends, that if you are achieving the good ligamentostasis and articular surface congruity is maintained, and fair number of time we have seen the fracture line is not passing through the lunate or the scaphoid surface. That's why we get a big chunk of the styloid process, so which is articulating basically with the scaphoid. So if it is in the midline, where there is a ridge, so then it does not cause much problem. That is what they that is the reason for the recommendation. And ulnar variants, they have put a lot of stress on that. Because if there is a...
So restore the length, basically.
Yes, to restore, basically to restore the length.
So when I was a resident, there was this paper, I think from out of Scotland, McQueen, if I'm not mistaken, which talked about the fact that whether you do anatomic reduction or you don't do anatomic reduction, at the end of 1 year, the functional results are more or less the same.
Yes, precisely.
I found that very difficult to believe because I found, you know, patients who are not anatomical don't seem to have such a good result. What is your experience, sir, with...
First, I want to pose a question to the house. Who would like to have an external fixator put into his hand or both the limbs as a primary treatment for the wrist injury? Raise your hands up, please, if you want an
external fixator. So why both, sir?
The question is, would you like an external fixator as a mode of treatment on your case? Please raise the hand if yes.
So why do you say both?
Both, because there could be bilateral injuries.
Are you talking only about bilateral?
No, bilateral or unilateral. Bilateral or unilateral, there is only one here, Dr. Prabhu.
No, two.
Three. Sir, maybe.
Yeah, okay.
Piche bhi do jane, sir.
Three. Only three out of maybe 100.
No, but sir, you have to ask them the next question. How many of you all will put on a JESS fixator for a fracture lower end radius? Everybody's hand will go.
No, that is true. But the percentage is less than 5. So it doesn't go. That is the first question. Number two, some years ago, there was a professor from a very big orthopedic center from Hamburg. He had come here and he showed many cases. Intertan was one of the things that he suggested. He and his group analyzed 2,000 papers on the distal radial fractures, 2,000. And they found that at the end of a particular period, the functional recovery was the same in both the groups. So there are lots of variations. If I have to have an external fixator in my hand, I won't take it. Because the greatest bugbear is the stiffness. Stiffness because you are not able, because of pain, inadequate fixation, pain tract infection, whatever, you are not able to move the fingers and you are unable to move the wrist, which you will be able to do most of the time in 5 or 6 days in an internally fixed distal radius fracture. So I would go with a distal radial fracture anytime.
So he's a proponent of plating, but also is the fact that today, with locked plating available, the scenario has changed compared to, you know, the plates that were available for these multi-fragmented fractures. With locked plating today, the scenario is different than what it was maybe, let's say, 10 years ago.
And sir, so I would not completely agree with you. I am presenting here, the presentation was mainly to show that it is a viable alternative. I am no way suggesting that each and every patient should be external.
Fair enough. Yeah.
See, you have also accepted there are two common variables which are most important as regards the results are concerned. One is the length of the radius, what is achieved on day one.
Yes.
And second is how you have taken care of the subluxation of the wrist.
Yes.
Like a fixator cannot address the second part, the subluxation, the dorsal subluxation of the carpus, which invariably occurs in most. It cannot address.
Why?
Because let me complete. Because there is no fixation from the fixator to the distal fragment of the radius. You are indirectly fixing the fracture. So that is one. Second issue is the radial length, what you achieve on day one. And after you remove the fixator, there is a subsequent loss, which is seen in almost all the papers what are described. Second, your comparative studies, what you have shown, you know, like, with the number of classifications which are available today, you cannot club every distal radius fracture to be fixed with a plate, or all the distal radius fracture fixed with an external fixator. These cannot be compared. You have to be specific. Third issue is most of them, like the complex injury, have a diapunch element where the lunette goes inside the lunette fossa, splits into two. So the fixator cannot address that. And fourth issue was the ligamentotaxis, where the intercarpal ligament, intercarpal joint, and the radiocarpal joint, you cannot have a control of distraction of these two joints, and which invariably leads to a considerable stiffness.
Can I answer everything one by one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the third issue, the most important, what he says is exactly opposite. Probably Dr. Thakur can address that, is the heat generated by a pin is much more as compared to a drill or a pin. The reason is the pins or the drill will have a flute for the bone dust to escape, while as a K-wire doesn't have that, and that is why the heat generated with a K-wire is much more. If used in diaphysis, metaphysis, it does not make any difference. For a extra, for a extra articular, it is fine, but not for an intra-articular
extra
fracture.
Articular, you don't need it. Now I'll answer each and every question one by one. First, what you said that ligamentotaxis is achieved, agreed. Second part, you say that it is invariably lost. Now that is where the crux of the issue arises. You have to supplement with a small K wire. Believe me, 1.5 millimeter K-wire is sufficient enough, and you can incorporate it again into the small, we have fixed joints available, which can be fixed to the primary frame, and you can reattach over there. After the reduction is achieved, before you wash out, you put that. That is one part.
Okay.
Second question. What you suggested, that the lunette is never reduced. Now again, same thing happens. When you are putting in a K-wire, additional K-wire, so you have to assess each and every fracture. I am trying to suggest a alternative one. Two, I am giving you a solution wherein what situations what you are telling me which can be handled. So you that same K-wire, if you put it a little more transversely, then it will be acting as a, like we have a polar screws, it will just lift up the fragment and it will not allow it to collapse. And that can be still incorporated. It is not for a fixation. It is a temporary, keeping it for a couple of weeks and you can just pull it out. That is second part. Third part, what you said, sorry, you said something about the drill pin. Well, the K-wire, the AOK wires have a tip, which is a triangle tip, which causes the least amount of heat. And the other thing is that I'm subject to correction. I don't have problems in that. And other thing you say something. Four things you say.
DRUJ.
Well, once you establish the length, it is established. Plating also, you don't address the, you are not fixing DRUJ. And the frame which I have shown specifically, we can put bilateral frame wherein you totally immobilize. You are not allowing the movement of the DRUJ at all initially. So as to, that answers your question. So if you immobilize that, you do not do that. What frame I have shown is a two frames in a radius only where you are starting immobilization on day one, which you can. And other thing is that this is such a, I would say you can do anything with these frames. There is no fixed things you have to do this and that.
Okay.
That's a variables can
question.
Be added to that.
Question.
Yeah, actually, it's just a comment and my experience, which I thought might be helpful to the juniors. My background of training in JJ Hospital, we used to put quite a few of these frames. After going to England for a long period of time, I worked with Dr. Subodh Deshmukh. He's one of the KMites, one of the leading hand surgeons in Birmingham City. And he is one of the pioneers in the volar plating for the distal radius. The first paper with 125 cases came out when I was his registrar. So now, the thing which was taught to us in Birmingham City was, they heavily discouraged us from putting external fixators. for the lower end radius. The reason being the functional outcomes were extremely guarded. We landed up seeing patients in the OPD who had stiff wrists. I second what Dr. Modi is saying, and stiff hands, and they were not very acceptable situation, though anatomically you might get the length right. So I'm quite, I feel encouraging when he showed some functional outcome results, which are corollaries to all this. But what Subodh Deshmukh used to advocate was you can use an intraoperative distractor to reduce the fracture, and at the same time you can put the volar plate on. And most of the time the length is maintained. Supplementary bone grafts also were not required. So, but if you see the functional outcome following that, especially early mobilization, the restoration of the radial length, the inclination, it is phenomenally superior to what a patient with an external fixator can get. But that doesn't mean we don't have to put an external fixator. If it is an unreconstructible fracture, where we are just not able to put a plate, where the screws are not holding, obviously that's a definitive option. Second thing is what Dr. Sangeet mentioned, who was my boss before, is about the column fixation. You do get an option of the column fixation nowadays to get a better hold in the distal fragments.
With a plate.
With the plate. So I think the to winding up in a nutshell, have a higher threshold for an external fixator, that what I was taught. Of course, the paradigm might shift. I'm not saying about that. Thanks.
How many people use JESS fixator for, let's say, distal fractures of the distal, extra-articular fractures of the radius?
Extra-articular, you don't need it.
None of you all?
But extra-articular, you don't need it.
Everybody, how many people use a lock plate for distal radius fractures? Okay, most people. And how many people use K-wire and cast? Okay, this. Right. So, one of the comments in relation to what you said is, of course, the bad results of external fixation could be because of the bad use of external fixation. So, when I have debates with Sudhir multiple times, and over distraction is one of the causes. So once you've got your reduction, you need to release. So there is probably a place, sir. One line from you, in terms of heat generation.
Undisputedly, heat generation by a K wire would be much higher than a sharp drill bit.
I accept your word, sir.
And whether it's made by AO or Sushrut or anybody, it's the same, because
flute is lesser.
As Sangeet has said, that there is no way to take out the bar, and one has to be extremely careful.
Sangeet,
we have a standard. We have a standard when we do Elisera workshops. We ask them to drill like true orthopedic surgeons. You know how orthopedic surgeons can't wait for anything. Bzzz, go completely through, then stop and just try and hold the tip of that wire. When it has gone through a saw bone, you can't touch it. It's that hot. So, it has to be a stop-start technique. It has to be cooled. That is for anything. Yes, last.
Sorry for my voice. The problem is over-distraction. The stiffness, what yes. Dr. Mohite was saying, was because the over-distraction.
Over-distraction.
Okay, so that has to be avoided at any cost. And whatever stiffness that we have seen is from other cases also. So we've done more than 500 cases of external fixator of the lower end of the radius, and we do not find any stiffness, because proper use of external fixator is extremely important. If you have a problem, that means you have not used it properly.
Yeah, so this is one of those things, no, where the not much of it. See, one of the things, biggest things, is that the JESS fixator is pretty different from most of the other fixators that are described, which are based on pins, it is on screws.
Unscrained. It is unstrained. Yeah. Totally unconstrained.
No, there are other unconstrained, but most of them are based on, threaded, kind of.
So threaded wires makes it rigid. The whole concept is that this
so
is...
So all the numbers, actually, the studies have to come, or the results have to come from us only.